Well, welcome to Beverley Baptist Church service for June the 7th. You find me enjoying a cup of coffee and the views of Beverley Westwood. Particularly, I'm just drinking in the contentment of the cows, the golfers and the dog walkers, and just appreciating what a glorious environment we live in here in Beverley. And just thanking God for all the resources, the rich resources he's given us in this context that we live in. So we're coming here to not just appreciate God's creation and his resources, but to specifically appreciate God. So we're going to move into a time of worship in a minute. But first of all, let me just kind of orientate what we're going to be focusing on this morning. As a church, we're moving into a series based on the resources from Spring Harvest this year, entitled The Church Unleashed. And it follows on from what we were looking at and focusing on last week, which was the Pentecost and what Pentecost means for us today, and how Pentecost originally unleashed us as the people of God into something different. And so we're going to be exploring that in more detail in the coming weeks. But this week, the focus is the church unleashed as family. And we're going to be spending some time looking at how God works through us as family in our time, not just in this beautiful place of Beverley, but also we're going to be doing a bit more of a focus outside our own environment into what's going on in God's world. But before we do that, let's focus on God. And I'm going to ask David to come and read Psalm 133 for us before we go into a time of sung worship.
I'm going to read Psalm 133, and I'm reading it from the Passion Translation. A Song to Bring You Higher by King David. How truly wonderful and delightful to see brothers and sisters living together in sweet unity. It's as precious as the sacred scented oil flowing from the head of the high priest Aaron, dripping down upon his beard and running all the way down to the hem of his priestly robes. This heavenly harmony can be compared to the dew dripping down from the skies upon Mount Hermon, refreshing the mountain slopes of Israel. For from this realm of sweet harmony, God will release his eternal blessing, the promise of life forever. And now Naomi is going to lead us in a time of sung worship.
Let's join together and sing, Blessed Be Your Name.
Well,
I introduced this new song a few weeks ago, so let's continue worshipping the goodness of God.
Yeah.
Thank you, Naomi, for leading us in that. So we're going to be listening to a Bible reading in a minute that talks about some of the early church's experiences of what it is to be in God's family. And I've asked one of the younger members of our community to read for us, and he's also done that in a really special way. So James, over to you.
Verses 42 to 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favour of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved.
Well, thank you, James, for that. That was a real treat. It never ceases to amaze me, the creativity that we have within our church community, from the youngest to the oldest. That was really special. So thank you for not just reading that beautifully, but for your animation as well. It's good to see that God is using us creatively in lockdown and inspiring us creatively in lockdown. And another thing that actually has carried on, a church, our own personal church tradition, our community tradition, is celebration and celebration of birthdays and anniversaries. If you have a birthday or an anniversary or something to celebrate this week, would you let Karen, our community administrator, know so that she can engage those crunchy angels who will be winging a crunchy to you at some point this week? Can I also point you to the family news and the notices that are in Buzz? That's our newsletter. That's available electronically. Again, Karen can send that to you if you aren't aware of all of that. We're going to then now move into another creative time for our younger members of our community. And they were sent this week some resources to work through. This is a time where if you want to, you can go and engage with those resources while we move into a time of prayer and then hear what Phil has to say to us. So it was getting to be quite chilly on the Westwood and it was beginning to rain. So we've come back to our nice warm kitchen. We're going to be moving into a time of prayer conscious communication with God in a few minutes. And let's just come back to what our focus of this morning's time together is. We're looking at the church unleashed as family. And we've all been in families. We're all still in families. And sometimes those families have highs and sometimes those families have lows. In our time of prayer this morning, we're going to look at the church family in our wider context, because sometimes it's helpful to look wider than our own personal situations. And as the family of God, we're called to look after one another, as Phil's going to be talking about more in his sermon later, as he's making reference to being involved in each other's lives. And that involves being involved in the lives of family wider. And there are lots of things that we could look at this morning. There are lots of things going on in the world where we could stand alongside our brothers and sisters in Christ and wider communities in prayer and other ways of supporting. I've had to fine hone those down to just one or two things because we just haven't got time. And one of the most shocking and challenging events of recent days has been the situation all across United States of America as a result of the death of George Floyd. And this is, I think, provoked a wider conversation about the things that are going on that COVID-19 and lockdown has almost put a spotlight on. As we've been in lockdown, it's also brought a lot of things to the light and to the fore in our thinking. And and particularly after the death of George Floyd, that's really impacted our brothers and sisters of colour. And I would like us to hear some wider voices as we move into a time of prayer from people mainly of colour who were protesting over this week as to the reasons why they've been protesting. And hopefully that will inform how we pray, not just this morning, but going forward for this particularly challenging and painful situation.
I don't want us to be looked at as rioters or looters. We're protesting passionately. We're passionate people.
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
If you don't speak up, then everything's just going to be silent. There's going to be no justice.
Exactly.
Instead, there has to be justice for all the people that died with this police brutality.
I'm just tired of hearing about black people dying. I'm tired of being afraid just by being stopped by the cops.
What I think needs to be recognized is that this country has a history of enslaving, beating, brutalizing, and killing black people for centuries in this country. So instead of really chastising us and questioning the nature of our protests and the way that we respond to actions, I think it's important to recognize who has set the tone and forced our hand to respond in the way that we have in the same ways that you have with our people for centuries.
I want us to treat black lives as our own on a daily basis, in the classroom, out of the classroom. I want it in the streets. I want it when somebody is pulled over.
We know that COVID-19 is still happening and that, like, this really increases the risk that you're gonna, that something might go down. But to see everyone here in support of, like, my people and the injustices that we face throughout the country every single day of our lives, is really moving.
I think our message was clear at first and then it ended up being clouded, but at the end our message is still the same. Black Lives Matter.
Both the Baptist Union of Great Britain and the Yorkshire Baptist Association have responded to this situation, and I would just like to read the Yorkshire Baptist Association's response to the recent protests in the States. And we're going to do what they suggest at the end of their statement, which is to have a minute's silence and to use that time to come alongside our brothers and sisters in Christ and the wider community to make a stand on this issue. So they start their letter to our brothers and sisters in the YBA. Genesis 4:10 says, "Your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground." Over these last few days, the murder of George Floyd in Minnesota, US, and the eruption of protest in its wake has broken with urgency and magnitude into our minds. To hear the cry of those living through lifetimes, indeed generations, of injustice has broken our hearts. Concerned though we are to support you in our pathway through the COVID-19 pandemic, we cannot be silent at these events, nor silent as we recognise with repentance that the sin of racism lodges within our own hearts, lives, and institutions. What we see and hear are not new conditions of injustice. Yet God graciously calls us once again to work with all our energy to dismantle those strongholds of evil, which are prejudice, systemic racism, and inequality. We want to recognise and share the grief of those dearly beloved friends, people of colour who serve and worship with us in Yorkshire Baptist churches, knowing that there is a deep sense of shock, anger, and indeed weariness at seeing and feeling over again the burden of prejudice against them because of the colour of their skin. We, who are so privileged by our whiteness, want to commit ourselves to sharing in these sufferings through listening, through learning about the facts and the experience of people of colour in the UK, through allowing ourselves to be examined, and through speaking and acting with intention against all forms of prejudice, Even this week, we recognise the inequality of our own UK society as we learn of the disproportionate number of BAME deaths as a result of COVID-19. We believe that it is not okay to stand on the sidelines and watch, but that Jesus is calling us from passivity into embarking on a joint journey of freedom. We declare afresh that all are created equally beloved as children of our Heavenly Father, and that all people bear God's image. As Baptists, we began our history in protesting for freedom and liberty for all. We say again that it is our duty to examine ourselves, to be informed, and to engage actively in dismantling racism in both the public and private spheres that we each inhabit. This is not something we can achieve in a fleeting concern, but rather a commitment to a lifetime journey. As an act to begin this journey, we invite you to mark today as a day of lament, repentance, and prayer, to use silence to remember the victims of racism, and then commit to not remain silent as long as others do not have the space to breathe with which we enjoy. Commit to an intentional journey towards the holy justice of God. And that was written by Graham, Mary and Clive from the Yorkshire Baptist Association. And we're now going to have a minute's silence to think about those issues that were raised in their statement. Amen. As well as being aware of the journey of lament and praying into situations of horror and hardship, it's also important to remember that who God is. We have a great and loving God, and he reaches out into our personal situations and circumstances in such a variety of ways. And we're going to now look at a video produced by Open Doors, which is an organisation that works with Christians all around the world who are persecuted in one form or another for their faith in Christ. And this video is an illustration of how God is working in interesting parts of the world and leading people to him through all sorts of forms and media. And I'm going to let the video talk for itself.
À ce moment-là, j'ai pensé que il y a aucun chrétien ou chrétienne de l'Afrique du Nord. J'ai pensé que c'est moi la première personne qui pense de devenir chrétienne en Afrique du Nord. J'ai commencé les recherches sur YouTube. J'ai essayé de voir, de connaître c'est qui Jésus. Et sur Facebook aussi, j'ai essayé de trouver quelque chose. Il y avait une fille qui est venue pour me donner la Bible. Et ils ont dit qu'on ira à l'église. Et j'ai posé la question, est-ce que je peux venir avec vous? Elle a dit oui. Le pasteur était en train d'enseigner par rapport à Jean. Je suis la vie, le chemin, la vérité. Ce jour-là, je n'ai pas voulu quitter l'église. À chaque fois que je rentre à la maison, je veux toujours lire la Bible seulement. Je ne fais que lire la Bible. C'était comme la nourriture ou... Toujours, à chaque fois que je lis, j'ai besoin encore de lire, encore et encore et encore. Mon père, il ne sait pas. J'ai essayé deux fois de parler, d'ouvrir une discussion avec mon père. J'ai dit, bon, si j'ajoute une autre mot, ça y est, il va me tuer. Maintenant, mon entourage, il n'y a aucun chrétien. Mais dans la Bible aussi, ils nous disent qu'on doit être une communauté, l'unité. On doit être dans le même corps, tous les chrétiens.
So we're going to finish the time of prayer today again through another video, because I felt that my voice just couldn't really illustrate the bigness of the family of God. And the video we're going to see now is a lovely prayer that was produced by Tear Fund probably about a month ago, so during the lockdown worldwide. And here, this video illustrates how big and wide and varied the family of God is. So as people from around the world lead us in the time of prayer, do follow the words, do say the words out as well, and join in the prayer as we bring and focus all our worries and concerns, all our thanksgiving and praise together in with the rest of the body of Christ.
Lord, you are our refuge and strength.
E ajuda-nos a não temer.
As the earth is shaken,
tinomiriraime.
Tu estás con nosotros, Señor Todopoderoso.
You are calling us to be still.
Be still, not afraid.
Nem passividade.
That you will be exalted among the earth.
Be still.
Be creative.
A être généreux.
A ser amables.
Believe and trust
that you are God.
A estar quietos.
Be mindful.
A ser tu pueblo, tu amado.
Lord, we bring our hopes to you.
Our families.
Our finances.
Nossa saúde.
E em nossa quietude.
Em nossos hogares, em nossos negócios, em nossos hospitais.
Tu sairia kuona unayo tenda.
We pray for wars to cease.
Oramos para que cesen las guerras, para que las armas se destruyan.
And peace declared as we face this together.
We pray for the people trapped in their homes.
With those who do them harm.
To help to be released and restored.
We pray for communities unable to isolate.
Obligés de cohabiter, craignant d'être infectés.
Ayúdalas a estar seguras y sanas.
نصلي من أجل شفاء المرضى.
Ivai nao mukushungurudzwa nokuchema kwavo.
Acompaña a las personas en medio de su ansiedad y aflicción.
Help us to be still.
As you are exalted among the nations,
exalted in all the earth.
Até mesmo nesse momento.
Be with us.
Be our fortress, Almighty God.
Amen.
So in a few moments, we're going to hear my mother-in-law, Ruth, and she's going to read another story in Acts that illustrated how the early church did family together. And both the story that James read and the story that we're about to hear will be referenced in Phil's sermon. So we're going to go straight from Ruth's reading to Phil's sermon, and that's going to then feed into our last worship song, where we can have time to reflect and respond to what Phil has said.
The reading is from Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 35. The believers share their possessions. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land and houses sold them, brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need.
Blood is thicker than water. You've almost certainly heard the phrase. I wonder what it means to you. These days, people use it to emphasize the strength of family. Nothing holds us together more than our shared blood. Loyalty to family comes before other commitments. Which is actually the complete opposite of what it was originally intended to mean. The original phrase, blood of the covenant is thicker than the water of the womb. The exact origins are unclear, but it was probably coined in the Middle Ages or the Reformation period to emphasize that the blood of Jesus unites us as church in bonds that are stronger than even our physical family ties. Our primary loyalty is no longer to those to whom we are genetically related, but rather to Jesus Christ. And with that, to those with whom we share that deeper covenant relationship. As his church, joined together as those who've been redeemed through his blood shed on the cross, and remembering his death as we share bread and wine, symbolizing his body broken and his blood shed for us. So the complete opposite of what people use the phrase to mean today. This week we're beginning a 7-week series, The Church Unleashed, loosely based on resources from this year's spring harvest. When the Holy Spirit fell at Pentecost, creating the church, empowering those first disciples, he unleashed them on the world to work to bring about the kingdom of God. He created something new. But what was it to be? What was it to look like? What were to be the fundamental characteristics of this new entity? We're going to look at 7 over the course of the series, but we begin this morning with the church unleashed as family. And that's the right starting place, I think, because that's at the heart of everything else the church does. Our identity as a group of people whose ties with one another and with Jesus are central to who we are, and more important than any other way in which we could define or describe ourselves. What does that mean? My current plan is that each week in this series, I'm going to try and hold three questions in mind. What does this mean in principle? What does it mean now as we're locked down? What might it mean in the future as we come back into more normal life? So what does it mean to describe the church as family? I always have a slightly uneasy relationship with that phrase. I use it because I often can't think of a better one. But I'm aware for many that family is a complicated word. Family is not always love and care and devotion and unity. It's not all about picture postcard holiday snaps and Hallmark cards. Family may mean disagreement, violence, estrangement, abuse, neglect. So in describing church as family, as often with such words, we need to be careful about what we mean by the words that we're using. And rather than starting with our ideas of family, positive or negative, coloured by our own experiences, we start with what the church is or what the church should be. And we allow that to define what it means to be brothers and sisters together. And so we come to our reading, a well-known passage from Acts chapter 2, describing the practice of the early church, what they were like as a family, as a community. There's much could be said from this passage, and much has been said by me as well as others. And I don't want to get into the detail of the activities of what they did today particularly. But I want to see what we can pull out from this passage about their underlying ethos as a community. What defined them as family? And firstly, I think we see that there's a relationship of togetherness. All the believers were together, we read verse 44. Physical togetherness in a number of different ways. They continue to meet together daily in the temple courts as a church made up at this point entirely of those who were Jewish or converts to Judaism. They continued their previous practices of Jewish worship. But they also met in each other's homes for fellowship, to eat together, to share the bread and wine of communion. But this was more than a physical togetherness. Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 35, echo and perhaps expand a little on the verses that we're considering this morning. We read there that all the believers were one in heart and mind, one motivation, one purpose, one uniting ideology. And as a result of that, they had everything in common. They were willing to give up their possessions to benefit those who had a greater need. Secondly, this is a relationship we see from the heart. Verse 46. They met together with glad and sincere hearts, and with that, praising God. What unites them together is the sincerity of their changed hearts, refocused on each other and on God, all of this held together within a framework of worship and as an outworking of the response to what Jesus had done for them. Because all of this, Acts chapter 4, verse 33 tells us, that God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all. All of this was a result of God's grace at work among them, powerfully at work in them all through the Holy Spirit. This passage follows Pentecost for a reason. They couldn't have done it before, even if they thought of doing it, even if they thought of living like this. The Holy Spirit is what provides both the motivation and the power. God was working in them all, without exception. So they were united together in that grace into one family, one community. A tie, a bond, which was far stronger than any other relationships they may have. The blood of Jesus, the grace of Jesus, thicker than water. And thirdly, this was a relationship that was outwardly open. The way they lived found favour with those outside. And this was visible. This was not hidden away. This was something that those outside saw how they were living and found it attractive and were attracted to and embraced for themselves, as daily others were added to their number. This family, church as family at its best, is a powerful witness to the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, which transforms not just those of us in the church, but those outside as they see who we are and how we live as the people of God. That's the ideal, at least. And this account that Luke gives us is possibly idealized. Was this ever the reality? Perhaps in those most early days, but even then, we can't begin to imagine the effect of a group of just over 100 people adding 3,000 more in one day and then more and more each day from that. Luke is setting out how things were at their best, the official position, as it were, of how the church was. But we don't have to read very far to find the reality of how often they fell short. We've already mentioned how Acts 4 reiterates and expands on today's reading. But that's followed immediately with chapter 5 and the story of Ananias and Sapphira, possibly, I think, the most difficult story in the New Testament. As Luke writes it, Ananias and Sapphira are struck dead by the Holy Spirit for lying about the amount of money that they got for their property. I can't divert into the issues that causes. I will happily talk it through with anyone who'd find that helpful. But for today's purposes, we simply note that it shows that not everybody bought wholeheartedly into this family vision. And then Acts chapter 6, we find arguments in the church about the distribution of food to widows, allegations of favouritism, lack of equality, division on ethnic lines. Even this early church family has its arguments and its tensions, and that's a precursor to a bigger disagreement to come about the place of Gentiles in the church, and if and how they can be welcomed to join with Jewish Christians in the worship of Jesus. We'll look at how those disagreements were resolved in a later week. But there were also, sadly, more personal disagreements. Perhaps on one level smaller, but they weren't big issues that were engulfing the whole church. But in some ways, they're more difficult and they're more painful. Acts 15. Paul says to Barnabas, "Let us go back and visit the believers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they are doing." And Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them. But Paul did not think it wise to take him, because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and left, commended by the believers to the grace of the Lord. Paul and Barnabas have this irreconcilable issue which divides them, but also appears to drag the church into it too. Paul is sent with the blessing of the church, commended by the believers to the grace of the Lord. It doesn't say that Barnabas was in the same way. All of these show that even this early church family was not perfect, because it was made up of imperfect human beings. There were disagreements, there were differences, there were flashpoints, as there always have been and always will be within the Church of Christ. But still, the underlying ethos was that of a united family, looking out for each other's needs, one in heart and mind, living in the grace of Jesus, and looking outwards to the world. So what does this mean in a COVID world? How do these three characteristics play out for us at the moment? Togetherness. We're in a time when our physical togetherness is restricted, and may be so for some time. And we need to be honest here. I'm going to put on the agenda for our next leadership team meeting for us to begin to talk about what our next steps might be. But we need to be realistic. There's talk about possibly churches being allowed to meet again from July, maybe. But even if that happens, it will be with heavy restrictions. And I want to say that on an ideological level, social distancing and church are contradictory. Church is about togetherness, not distancing. I'm not saying that that doesn't mean that we will find ways to gather that meet the legal requirements. If that's useful for people, then we'll do what we can. But there's a fundamental sense in which it won't be church, at least not as it's intended to be. And on a more practical note, even if those social distancing requirements are reduced from the current 2 metres to 1 metre, as has been talked about, but there's no guarantee will happen, even at 1 metre, the hall at the grammar school wouldn't fit all our congregation. So we're talking months before we can all be together again, potentially. And technology can be brilliant, and we are so blessed with the technology that we have in our congregation to pull together these video services, to enable Zoom prayer meetings and house groups and the WhatsApp groups and all of that. And the desire to set these up has been great to see. I've been so encouraged by how much people have wanted to be connected, even when that's meant learning new technology that's taken them out of their comfort zone. Because we are a family. That's such a strength of this fellowship. We value time with each other. We want to see each other's faces. We want to talk. We want to pray. It's not the same. It's fellowship of a sort. And we can pray and we can share teaching. But we can't share communion, properly at least. We can't give each other a hug. We can't eat together. We can't praise God together in the way that we're used to. It's an imperfect replacement for all of us. But I think I also need to say that actually there are some within our fellowship for whom it's more than that, that actually connecting together in this way actually reminds them so much of the lack of normality and of physical contact that it actually drags them down and is unhelpful. And so they choose to opt out. And if that's you, that's okay. Don't do what isn't good for you. But do please keep in touch by some means so that we can continue to support and pray for you. And as lockdown is being eased, let's get creative. If you've got a big garden, invite 5 other people around and have an outdoor prayer meeting. Or just a social catch-up. If you haven't got the garden, arrange to meet on the Westwood for the same. Prayer walk together at a social distance. Whatever it might be. As we've said, it's not just about that physical togetherness. It's about a more fundamental togetherness of heart and mind. It's about our connection with the people of Jesus as family. And here too, I've been so encouraged by so much of what I've seen during this lockdown. People in the church community posting their needs and the willingness of others to lend things, to give things away, to give their time, to shop, to help practically, truly putting the needs of others in the church family as our highest priority. And I've seen this from the heart. It's gladly and sincerely, not because people feel they must or they'll be judged if they don't, but because of a genuine love and compassion for one another. A number of people have commented to me how during this time they've got to know people in the church they wouldn't normally have talked to, or they'd only have talked on a very surface level. And they've benefited greatly from those new and deeper friendships. And that's powerful. That's the spirit of Jesus at work. That's the church being unleashed into the world as something different, something of the kingdom. And it will be noticed, it has been noticed, by those outside the church. Because church at its best, as family, is attractive to a world out there where people often don't have that sense of togetherness with others. Outside of their physical family, if they have any such, so many people have no one that they feel they can turn to for such help. No one who will prioritise them and their needs. And so in as much as we are able, we need to open our arms wide to share that family love with those who are not yet part of the family. To give to everyone who has need outside of the church as well as inside. To draw others into the family. And there'll be more of that next week when we think of the church as servant. So that's now. What about post-COVID, when we can physically meet again together? What will it mean for the church to be family then? Well, our meeting together is important. But I think that we learned from the early church that we don't need to gather all in one place at one time to be church. 3,000 were added in one day. There's no way they ever met all together. And yet they were one church. Because they were one family. With one concern for one another. United in the grace and love of Jesus Christ. Filled with one Holy Spirit. Many of you will have heard me say things like this before. That church is more than our Sunday gatherings. That my vision for church, for any church, for this church, would include different groups of people meeting at a variety of times in a number of different ways, but all part of one church, even though some of them might never meet each other. Because how often do you get all your family together in one place? Unless you've got a very small family. But you're still family. You meet up in smaller subsets, overlapping subsets, and you supplement that by other means of keeping in touch. This current situation gives us the catalyst, perhaps, to break even more our reliance on Sunday morning gathering to express our togetherness, to open up new ways that we can be one church together, tied together by technology, by personal relationships, as well as, yes, by gathering together. A few of us have been exploring an organisation called Big Life. They describe themselves as a disciple-making organisation. They're something that some of us perhaps might see as a church-planting organisation. They're built around the idea of small groups that learn together, that grow together, and intentionally reach out to others to start new small groups, which replicate into new small groups. Thousands of such groups have been started across the world over the past 20 years in India and other places. And the Yorkshire Baptist Association is now seeing what we can bring from that, what we can learn from that into the UK context. And there's already some groups planned in this area and we'll see where God might take that. Small churches growing, replicating. And yes, maybe at times those small churches will gather together, but not weekly. But they're still one church. Very much like that first church in Jerusalem. With one heart, one mind, but looking outwards, seeking that daily others will be added to their number. That's just one example, and we'll see where God might take that journey. But in that way, or in other ways, as we emerge from this pandemic, why we will rejoice that we can meet together again. It's not an option to just slip back into how we did things before. We must be learning from our experience now. We must be listening to the Holy Spirit and looking for new ways in which we can express together our identity as one family. The family of God. Because that is what we are. Blood is thicker than water. The blood of Jesus that unites us together with each other, with the other churches in Beverley, and indeed with our brothers and sisters around the world, as we've already remembered in our service this morning. So may we continue to live out our togetherness in a wide variety of ways. And as we do so, may we enjoy the favour of all the people and see daily the Lord bringing others into the family of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Naomi. Well, we've come to the end of our time together. Don't forget, for all those who are Beverley Baptist regulars, you'll have been sent a Zoom link for our virtual coffee time at 11:30. Do come and join us. It's lovely to see people's faces. Also, if there are certain issues that you want to respond to that you've seen during our time together, and we will get some information to you. Or if there are things that came out of what we encountered today and you need to talk to someone again, contact Karen at the link that's going to be coming on the screen. If you want to know and respond in other ways in terms of giving to the work of organisations that support not just the people of God, but also wider situations that are going on in the world, you can go on places like the TIFF and all the Open Doors websites, and I'd encourage you to delve into seeing how you can respond with your finances as well as your prayers at this difficult time for all of us. So we're going to close today by saying the grace together, and the words are coming up on the screen, and even though you might only just hear my voice, just let's say it together and think of various members of our immediate church family in Beverley Baptist, and let's think of them as and hold them in our minds and our hearts as we say together, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.